fix the hymn board, the first hymn should be 338. Thank you.
I Good evening and welcome to our Good Friday service. I am Pastor Jenna Polkowski, pastor here at St. Andrew, and on behalf of our congregation, a welcome to all guests and visitors with us this evening. We are honored that you would worship with us tonight. I invite you to follow along in your bulletins tonight. I will not be introducing things as I normally would in worship. All of our hymn numbers are up on the hymn board as well as in your bulletins.
Thank you. himself. Grant that we who have been born out of his wounded side may at all times find mercy in him, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you, the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. I invite you to be seated.
The first reading for this evening is from the book of Isaiah, the 52nd and 53rd chapters. See, my servant shall prosper. He shall be exalted and lifted up and shall be very high. Just as there were many who were astonished at him, so marred was his appearance beyond human semblance and his form beyond that of mortals. So he shall startle many nations. Kings shall shut their mouths because of him. For that which had not been told them, they shall see, and that which they had not heard, they shall contemplate. Who has believed what we have heard? And to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? For he grew up before him like a young plant, and like a root out of dry ground. He had no form or majesty that we should look at him, nothing in his appearance that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by others, a man of suffering and acquainted with infirmity, and as one from whom others hide their faces, he was despised, and we held him of no account. Surely he has borne our infirmities and carried our diseases, yet we accounted him stricken, struck down by God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions, crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the punishment that made us whole, and by his bruises we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have all turned to our own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. Like a lamb that is led to the slaughter, and like a sheep that before its shearers is silent, so he did not open his mouth. By a perversion of justice, he was taken away. Who could have imagined his future? For he was cut off from the land of the living, stricken for the transgression of my people. They made his grave with the wicked and his tomb with the rich, although he had done no violence and there was no deceit in his mouth. Yet it was the will of the Lord to crush him with pain. When you make his life an offering for sin, he shall see his offspring and shall prolong his days. Through him, the will of the Lord shall prosper. Out of his anguish, he shall see light. He shall find satisfaction through his knowledge. The righteous one, my servant, shall make many righteous, and he shall bear their iniquities. Therefore, I will allot him a portion with the great, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong, because he poured out himself to death and was numbered with the transgressors. Yet he bore the sin of many and made intercession for the transgressors. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The second reading for this evening is from the book of Hebrews, the 10th chapter. After the Holy Spirit says, "This is the covenant that I will make with them after those days, says the Lord. I will put my law in their hearts and I will write them on their minds." He also adds, "I will remember their sins and their lawless deeds no more. Where there is forgiveness of these, there is no longer any offering for sin." Therefore, my friends, since we have confidence to enter the sanctuary by the blood of Jesus, by the new and living way that he opened for us through the curtain, that is, through his flesh, and since we have a great priest over the house of God, let us approach with a true heart, in full assurance of faith, with our hearts sprinkled clean from an evil conscience, and our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold fast to the confession of our hope without wavering, for he who has promised is faithful. And let us consider how to provoke one another to love and good deeds, not neglecting to meet together, as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
I invite you to please stand as you are able. The Passion of our Lord Jesus Christ according to St. John, beginning in the 19th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Now, it was the day of preparation for the Passover, and it was about noon. And Pilate said to the Judeans, "Here is your king." They cried out, "Away with him! Away with him! Crucify him!" Pilate asked them, "Shall I crucify your king?" The chief priests answered, "We have no king but the emperor." Then he handed him over to them to be crucified. So they took Jesus, and carrying the cross by himself, he went out to what is called the place of the skull, which in Hebrew is called Golgotha. There they crucified him, and with him two others, one on either side, with Jesus between them. After this, when Jesus knew that all was now finished, he said, in order to fulfill the scriptures, "I am thirsty." A jar full of sour wine was standing there. So they put a sponge full of the wine on a branch of hyssop and held it up to his mouth. When Jesus had received the wine, he said, "It is finished." Then he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. Beloveds of God, grace and peace to you in the name of the crucified Messiah. Amen. You may have noticed an addition to our space this evening. In case one massive cross hanging behind the altar wasn't enough of a reminder, we've laid one out on the ground. There's some additional items with this one as well. Bowls of sand and the altar kneeling pads. Candles for us to light and leave. Tonight we will take time to gather and pray around the cross. The cross that for so many of us has been and continues to be the symbol of our salvation, a symbol that points beyond itself and to the one who poured himself out for us. The symbol of the shape of our faith, a cruciform faith. I honestly don't know if I will ever be able to reconcile the symbol of our salvation with the reality of what the cross represented for first century Jews. In the first century, using a cross as a symbol of faith would be like us using an electric chair or a lethal injection chamber or a lynching tree as a symbol of faith today. Unthinkable, inconceivable, disturbing. The cross was only a statement of torture and empire and death and nothing, nothing else. John's Gospel, which we had our reading from tonight, was most likely written around 85 AD. When Rome destroyed the temple in 70 AD, they also brutally punished the inhabitants of the city. According to ancient historian Josephus, the Roman military amused itself with crucifying people out of their disgust and hatred for the Jerusalemites, totaling about 6,000 people nailed up around the city. A statement of torture and empire and death indeed. The disciples who only a few short chapters before had proclaimed Jesus as Messiah want him to be the one to pull down the crosses, to fight the empire with sword and shield. They didn't want him to fight the empire with grace and love and submission to death on a cross himself. It is here that the cruciform faith, that all things cross-shaped, cross-centered, cross-infused, demonstrates for us that we cannot expect God to operate within our constructed binary of human versus divine things. That loss, grief, vulnerability, and pain can only be human things. And that triumph, invincibility, power, and glory must be divine things. Instead, by submitting to the cross, Jesus insists that God is in the hard things, the low things, the scandalous things, the gritty, messy, broken things. God does not hold God's self remote from the worst of this world. Immunity and invincibility, those are our fantasies. They have nothing to do with the God who submitted to the cross. That is only the beginning of our cruciform faith, our cruciform life. To have our lives truly shaped by the cross that we wear and tattoo on ourselves and mark all over our notebooks and tablets and phone cases. To mark ourselves as such is to know that God is at the center of the world's pain and that we are called to live there too. I imagine that for many of us, the scandal and the horror of the crucifixion has long since faded. But the truth is that God died on the cross. Debbie Thomas writes, Jesus willingly took the violence, the contempt, the apathy, and the arrogance of this world and absorbed them all into his body. He resisted the powers, terrifying as they were, and in doing so declared solidarity for all time with those who are abandoned, colonized, oppressed, accused, imprisoned, beaten, mocked, and murdered. He took an instrument of torture and turned it into a vehicle of hospitality and communion for all people everywhere. He loved and he loved and he loved and he loved all the way to the end. This symbol of our faith, of our very life, it is the symbol that God has transformed. God has taken what the world intended for evil, the world intended for power and dominion, and transformed it into a means of love and grace and mercy. That statement of torture and empire and death is now our very source of life and praise and thanksgiving. Tonight, in just a little bit, you will be invited to come up and to pray around the cross, to take in this symbol that is more than just the shape, but is our way of life, a way of living into who God has created us to be with God's beloveds of all places and all times, all of God's beloveds. God takes what the world intends for evil, and in the shape of a cross, transforms the world. Amen. I know this is a bit of a new practice for us, so I want to introduce it. I will go ahead and get the main candles lit, but you are invited to come up as you see fit and to spend time in prayer around the cross. You're welcome to light a candle and to leave it. There are bowls of sand here, so it'll stand up and be a safe receptacle for any dripping wax. You're welcome to stand around the cross if that is more accessible, or sit in some of the front row chairs here, or to simply sit in your seats where you are and to reflect from there. You can take as long as you need or as little time as you need, but all are welcome at the foot of the cross where we meet Jesus this night.
Crucified. Two others also, who were criminals, were led away to be put to death with him. When they came to the place that is called the Skull, they crucified Jesus there with the criminals, one on his right and one on his left. Then Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing."
Thank you.
saying, "Are you not the Messiah? Save yourself and us." But the other rebuked him, saying, "Do you not fear God, since you are under the same sentence of condemnation? And we indeed have been condemned justly, for we are getting what we deserve for our deeds. But this man has done nothing wrong." Then he said, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." He replied, "Truly I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise." Soldiers did. Meanwhile, standing near the cross of Jesus were his mother and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved standing beside her, he said to his mother, "Woman, here is your son." Then he said to the disciple, "Here is your mother." And from that hour, the disciple took her into his own home. Came over the whole land until 3 p.m. At 3:00, Jesus cried out with a loud voice, "Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani," which means, my God, why have you forsaken me?"
Thank you.
After this, when Jesus knew that all was now finished, he said, in order to fulfill the scripture, I am thirsty. A jar full of sour wine was standing there, so they put a sponge full of the wine on a branch of hyssop and held it to his mouth. Received the wine, he said, it is finished. Then he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. Thank you. darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m. While the sunlights failed and the curtain of the temple was torn in two, then Jesus, crying with a loud voice, said, "Father, in your hands I commend my spirit." Having said this, he breathed his last.